बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम, वेलकम टू अल्ट्रा फिजिक्स। स्टूडेंट्स, इन टुडेज लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी अबाउट पार्टिकल डिटेक्टर्स। मेनली वी विल डिस्कस क्लाउड चैम्बर, इट्स ड्रॉबैक्स, बबल चैम्बर एंड ड्रॉबैक्स ऑफ बबल चैम्बर। एंड इन द लास्ट ऑफ लेक्चर we will study Cherenkov radiation. So let's start. Student, what is meant by a particle detector? So particle detector is a device which is used to detect, track or identify ionizing particles such as those produced by nuclear decay, cosmic radiation or reactions in a particle accelerator. So first type of particle detector is cloud chamber. Cloud chamber is a particle detector in which the path of a charged particle is made visible by the formation of liquid droplets along the trail of ions left by the particle as it passes through the gas of the chamber. You can see the diagrammatical view of cloud chamber. We have a radioactive source produces radiation and causes ionization of vapor, filtering soaked in alcohol to supply alcohol vapor to the chamber, plastic lead. Alcohol vapor condenses to form liquid droplets around the ionized molecule. Dry ice, which cools the alcohol vapor until it is saturated, forms with spot dry ice and lamp. Now, ions formed by incident radiation act as nuclei for the condensation of supersaturated water vapor. We have an alpha source, and these are the alpha particle tracks. Cosmic rays tracks and collision with atom of gas is shown. First instrument to make visual observation of incident radiation tracks is known as Wilson cloud chamber, which we are studying now. This chamber was first used in 1912 as particle detector and discovered by Charles Thomas Rees Wilson, a Scottish physicist. Wilson and Arthur Compton received the Nobel Prize in Physics in 1927 for their work on the cloud chamber. Cloud chamber played a prominent role in the experimental particle physics from 1920s to 1950s until the advent of the bubble chamber. Uniform magnetic field across the cloud chamber will move positive and negative charged particles in opposite directions. There are two main types of cloud chamber. First one is the expansion cloud chamber and the second one the diffusion cloud chamber. The expansion cloud chamber is the supersaturated state is produced by rapidly lowering the pressure in the chamber. The temperature drops as the air is expanded. This type of cloud chamber only shows tracks during this expansion and cooling state. We have an alpha source and air and max vapor for pumping. We have a pump. So it causes rapid lowering the pressure in the chamber. The temperature drops as the air is expanded. So this type of chamber is called as expansion cloud chamber. And the second one is diffusion cloud chamber. Solid carbon dioxide cools the chamber so that at one level the air is supersaturated. We have an alpha source and solid carbon dioxide. Air is saturated with max vapor. This type of cloud chamber is known as diffusion cloud chamber. Now we are seeing the tracks of the particles. This rear picture shows in a single shot the four particles that we can detect in a cloud chamber: proton, electron, muon possibly, and alpha. So you can see we have proton with delta rays, low energy electrons, high energy electrons are muons, and the alpha rays. Now you can see the tracks of alpha particles and electrons. The track of alpha particle is more prominent. You can also see the track of electrons in the picture. Now alpha tracks from radium source. When we have a radium source and a beta and alpha tracks in a single image. From radium source we have a beta tracks and alpha tracks, and you can see both these tracks in a single image. Now we discuss the working of cloud chamber, how it works. So the first cloud chamber used air saturated with water in a glass chamber. The bottom of this chamber could be pulled down to increase the volume of the chamber, causing the gas within it to expand as well, and as such do work. However, this change is adiabatic, that is, it involves no heat transfer. First law of thermodynamics states energy is conserved and can't be created or destroyed. So the energy for this expansion has to have come from somewhere, in this case the internal energy of the gas. The internal energy is related to the temperature of the molecules in the gas. So if the chamber expands, the temperature drops. This brings the water vapor close to condensing, making it become supersaturated. If an ionizing particle such as alpha or beta radiation passes through this vapor, then the ions form acts as point of condensation for the surrounding vapor, leading to the formation of visible clouds. Thermodynamics of a system. If V1 be volume, P1 saturated vapor pressure, and T1 is the vapor temperature, its mass can be calculated using ideal gas equation PV equals MRT. For adiabatic expansion, the relation is: for no condensation, for degree of supersaturation. The vapor pressure on small droplet is not the same as it for the plain liquid surface. For a drop of radius r, the saturated vapor pressure PS is given by the following relationship. In this relationship, the term with Z equals 0 derived by Kelvin and electrostatic term was introduced by J.J. Thomson, where P infinity equals normal saturated vapor pressure, M equals molecular weight of vapor, rho equals density, tau equals surface tension, epsilon equals dielectric constant of the medium, and all other symbols has usual meanings. Track of the particle in the presence of magnetic field. Now we are going to discuss the track of particle in magnetic field. Different particle have different track, depends on mass, charge and velocity of the incident radiation. In magnetic field, the particle is formed to move in a circular path where magnetic force equals centripetal force. BQV equals mv square over r gives the momentum of incident particle as p equals brq. Kinetic energy can be calculated using relativistic rest mass equation. Now we talk about the development of the cloud chambers. In 1895, Charles T. R. Wilson invents the cloud chamber to make small clouds in the laboratory due to his interest in their formation and the electrical and optical phenomena associated with them. In 1910, Wilson realizes that the cloud chamber could be used in the task of identifying and describing newly discovered subatomic particles emitted by radioactive materials. 1924, Patrick Blackett used the cloud chamber to observe the transmutation of nitrogen into fluorine, which then disintegrated into oxygen. In 1932, Blackett had devised another way to speed up research work. By using a spring-mounted diaphragm to quickly readjust the chamber back to the conditions required to observe a cloud trace. 1933, Carl D. Anderson discovers an anti-electron, the positron, in a cloud chamber. In 1936, Alexander Langstroth modified the chamber to produce its modern variant, the diffusion chamber. Using dry ice to form a temperature gradient meant there was always a supersaturated region, so particles could be detected constantly. And in 1947, J.D. Rochester and Clifford Charles Butler published the first cloud chamber images showing evidence for Kaan. Now there are also some drawbacks of this cloud chamber. We will discuss them. First drawback is, one disadvantage of cloud chamber is the relatively low density of the gas, which limits the number of interactions between ionizing radiation and molecule of the gas. Second drawback, liquid is more sensitive than cloud or vapor because liquid densities are higher than gas densities. Third, clouds don't stay long. And fourth topic is, the recent water data illustrates, unfortunately, that good data and bad data can look very similar. Now, our second topic is about bubble chamber. Bubble chamber is also a particle detector. It is a hollow container filled with a superheated transparent liquid and normally liquid hydrogen used to detect charged particles moving through it. The medium used in first bubble chamber was diethyl ether, helium, deuterium, propane, xenon, liquid hydrogen are also used for various purposes. The liquid which is used should have low surface tension, high vapor pressure and transparent nature for photographs. We have a liquid hydrogen and magnetic field around it, particles of, and the camera is above, fixed above, for viewing the tracks of the particles. Normally, liquid boils at its boiling point. Under high pressure, liquid can be heated well above its standard boiling point. At high pressure, a sudden release in pressure will leave the liquid in superheated state. Ionizing particle entry within a few milliseconds after the pressure is released will leave ions. These ions will act as condensation centers for the formation of vapor bubbles. These bubbles will grow quickly and attain visible size in 10 to 100 microseconds. You can see the diagrammatical view of bubble chamber. We have a liquid in a chamber, optic sheets, dimpled cooling jackets, magnet vacuum vessel, man vacuum vessel, superconducting magnet, sport skirt, chamber piston, coupler to expansion system, main way, chamber leg, vacuum tank or magnet leg, neutrino hadron beam entry point. This is the entry point for beam, camera nozzles, camera equipments for viewing the tracks of the particles. A line drawing showing the major elements of nail 15-foot bubble chamber. Bubble chamber was invented in 1952 by Donald A. Glaser, awarded the 1960 Nobel Prize in Physics, supposedly inspired by the bubbles in a glass of beer. The 15-foot diameter bubble chamber used at Fermilab during the 1970s was filled with a mixture of superheated liquid neon or hydrogen, wrapped in a huge supercooled superconducting magnet. A beam of high energy protons was directed onto an aluminium or aluminium oxide target and through the fluid, producing an electromagnetic shower of particle tracks consisting of microscopic bubbles in arcing trajectories. You can see a bubble chamber in the image on the right side. Tracks in hydrogen bubble chamber are shown in the image at CERN. These tracks are visible by using bubble chamber for the particles. Electrons and positrons produced simultaneously from individual gamma rays curls in opposite direction in the magnetic field of bubble chamber because of their charged nature. In the top example, the gamma ray has lost some energy to an atomic electron, which leaves the long track curling left. The gamma rays don't leave tracks in the chamber as they have no electric charge. You can see that a scattered atomic electron is electron and positron, while invisible gamma ray photons can't deflect because they are neutral, a more energetic electron-positron pair. The pair production, even that occurred in a bubble chamber, a gamma photon enters into the chamber from the left. The merged point is the point where the pair production happened. Due to the charge property, the electron and positron left a trail of tiny bubbles moving from left to right. You can see electron and positron, and this is the junction point of pair production where it happened. The merged point is the point where the pair production happened. Now, working of bubble chamber. So it's basically a large cylinder with a liquid heated at high pressure. With the entry of particle from entry point, pressure is decreased through a piston. The liquid as results enters into superheated metastable phase, and the charged particles create an ionization track around which the liquid vaporizes, forming microscopic bubbles, and the bubble density around a track is proportional to energy loss of the incident particles. As the chamber expands, the bubbles formed grow inside. The entire chamber is subject to a constant magnetic field, which causes charged particles to travel in helical paths, whose radius is determined by their charge to mass ratios and their velocities. The magnitude of charge of all known subatomic particles is the same as that of an electron. Their radius of curvature must be proportional to their momentum. Hence, by measuring their radius of curvature, momentum of incident radiation can also be calculated. Now, what are the significant achievements of bubble chamber? Notable discoveries made by bubble chamber include the discovery of weak neutral currents, established the soundness of the electroweak theory, and led to the discovery of W and Z bosons in 1983. Recently, bubble chambers have been used in research on weakly interacting massive particles. Bubble chamber also have some drawbacks. It was very successful in the past, however, it has limited use in modern day high energy experiments for other reasons. First reason is the photographic readout it output rather than three-dimensional electronic data makes it less convenient, especially in experiments which must be reset, repeated, and analyzed many times. Secondly, it is not continuously sensitive. Third, superheated phase must be ready at the precise moment of curing, which complicates the detection of short-lived particles. These chambers are neither large nor massive enough to analyze high-energy curings. Last one, hindering precise estimation of momentum owing to small radii of chamber. So due to such issues, bubble chambers have largely been replaced by wire chambers, which allow particles' energies to be measured at the same time. And another alternative technique used is the spark chamber. Now our today's last topic is about Cherenkov radiation and detectors. So what is a Cherenkov radiation? When a charged particle passes through an optically transparent dielectric medium with a velocity greater than the phase velocity of light in that medium, it emits photons. And these photons are called as Cherenkov radiation. The characteristic blue glow of an underwater nuclear reactor is due to Cherenkov radiation. It is named after Soviet scientist Cherenkov, the 1958 Nobel Prize winner, who was the first to detect it experimentally. A theory of this effect was later developed within the framework of Einstein's special relativity theory by Igor Tim and Elia Frank, who also shared the Nobel Prize. These radiations had been theoretically predicted by English polymath Oliver Heaviside in 1963. in papers published in 1888 to 1889. When a charged particle passes through an optically transparent dielectric medium with a velocity greater than the phase velocity of light in that medium, it emits strong photons called Cherenkov radiation at a characteristic polar angle that depends on the particle velocity. So you can see that when electrically charged particle passes through optical transparent dielectric medium with a velocity greater than the phase velocity, so these photons are produced, and these photons are called as Cherenkov radiations. Now, the polar angle which were made, so measurement of particle speeds can be made by measuring the angle of Cherenkov cone. A portion of the light emitted by the decelerated particle is coherent and is emitted at a characteristic angles, cos theta equals c by vn, where n is the index of refraction and v is the particle velocity, c speed of light. For water, we have refractive index equals 1.33. The limiting angle for high-speed particle is given by 41.2 degrees. Similarly, the threshold particle speed for Cherenkov radiation is calculated by the relation v equals c by n, which for an electron in water gives a threshold particle kinetic energy of 0.26 mega electron volt. Calculations are given. One of the valuable applications of Cherenkov radiation is in the detection of neutrinos. So it is used for the detection of neutrinos and distinguishing between different types of neutrinos. An energetic muon remains intact while slowing down, and its Cherenkov cone points out a well-defined circular ring on the detector array. You can see in the images. A high energy electron, on the other hand, will produce a diffuse ring on the detectors because it will produce a shower of electrons, each with its own Cherenkov cone. You can see the Cherenkov radiation cone for muon neutrino and electron neutrino electron shower. Cherenkov radiation glows because the core of advanced test reactor is submerged in water to keep it cool. In water, light travels at 75% the speed it would in the vacuum of outer space, but the electrons created by the reaction inside of the core travel through the water faster than the light does. Particles like these electrons that surpass the speed of light in water or some other medium such as glass create a shock wave similar to the shock wave form from a sonic boom. Cherenkov radiation glowing in the core of advanced test reactors are shown in the image. Now, what is Cherenkov detectors? Cherenkov detectors are designed to record these Cherenkov radiation produced by the incident charged particle. We have a Cherenkov radiator and light cone, incident cosmic rays, light box, and the reflected photons from Cherenkov light cone. A neutrino is basically an elementary matter particle of almost zero mass, only interacting through weak nuclear forces and gravity, leading to its unimpeded traveling through an ordinary solid matter at almost the speed of light. During a rare interaction between a neutrino and an electron in the water, the electron is accelerated at a speed greater than speed of light in water, producing a pulse of light called Cherenkov radiation, which is similar to a supersonic boom. These pulses are then detected by thousands of light amplifiers disposed everywhere on the pool surface. And the main type of Cherenkov detector, the super detector, is a 50,000 ton tank of water located approximately 1 kilometer under the ground. The water in the tank acts as both the target for neutrinos and the detecting medium for the byproducts of neutrino interaction. The observatory was also to search for proton decay and keep watch for supernova in the Milky Way galaxy. In the image is a super Cherenkov detector which is used to study neutrinos from different sources, including the sun, supernova, the atmosphere, and accelerators for proton decay. So students, in today's lecture we study about particle detectors, and mainly two types of particle detectors is cloud chamber, their drawbacks, similarly bubble chamber. And in the last of lecture we study about Cherenkov radiations and Cherenkov detectors. If you like this video, kindly subscribe my YouTube channel and also press the bell icon for more updates. Thanks for watching.